Put yourself in my shoes. You've just learned there's a firing squad gunning for you. You're thousands of miles from home. No one can help you get out of this mess. You'd be pissed off too. I just wish I'd directed my anger at the people who really deserved it. Like, instead of pushing away the only ones
who
might make whatever life had left ahead of me a bit more bearable.
This is my house, English boy. Do you understand?
Jet plane headed up to the sky. Spread wings and the clouds getting high.
Shoot first, ask questions after. That's how I used to do things.
So take me back to London.
Yo.
But after that madness that I caused in the canteen, I'd pissed Grant and Sonny right off. So here I was in hospital, with an even more busted up hand, and too much time alone with my thoughts.
I've just been told I'm getting death penalty at 25 years.
So take me back to London.
And the emotions and all of the realizations of actually being tortured have really started to sit in on me. And I kind of like went into a bit of like self-pity mode, I'm not gonna lie. Like, it kind of made me feel like I hated myself intensely, like for not being there for Amy, for not being there for my daughter.
My head was a mess. All I could think about was my daughter growing up without her dad. But 12 months ago, if you'd have told me I was about to have a kid, I'd have told you to jog on, mate. I was living my dream in Dubai. We hadn't been together long, but things were going really well with Amy. And then she dropped that bomb.
I've kind of got super sperm, so yeah, she ended up a bit pregnant. And I was like, I was like, oh God, I was like, my mum's gonna kill me. Because the one thing she said to me was just, don't go to Dubai and get women pregnant. I was like, come on, mum, I'm not gonna do that. And then I did it.
Jesus Christ.
I might not have been ready to be a dad, but I had to make a lot of big decisions fast. Because we weren't married, there was no way Amy could stay out here. It was too dangerous.
It's illegal to have her baby without getting married first. And doctors are obliged to report mothers of newborns to the police. Had Amy stayed in the country and given birth in a UAE hospital, she would have been arrested immediately after the baby was born for having a baby out of wedlock.
It was Dubai or the baby. So we legged it back to London. Maybe the way Faith came into this world should have been a sign that Dubai wasn't a place to be messed with. Easy to say with hindsight, isn't it? Fast forward 6 months and we were getting close to Amy's due date.
I was in a music studio and I was recording my song Blue Lights.
Last week, chilling on the roads with my peeps, them.
And Amy's messaged me like, I'm going into labour. And I'm like, I'm in the recording booth, yeah, like on the last part of the verse, like literally the last part of the whole song. I stepped out of the booth and I was like, my missus is about to squeeze one out, yeah? I've got to go. Got into the hospital. I was absolutely high as a kite, because I'd been in the studio all night smoking weed, drinking and that, so I was a bit buckled. I'm just like, like absolutely pooing myself. And then they gave me my beautiful daughter, and I was like, ah, I love you. Obviously, I loved it, but it was still like, you're scared. You're like, fuck, like, this little human being is now dependent on me. And what do I do when shit gets real?
Hey, you ready?
I'm not normally one to have regrets, but coming back to Dubai was the worst mistake of my life. I made a promise to myself that day that I'd do everything in my power to get home to my baby. And that meant taking back control. First thing I did when I got back to prison was make a phone call. When the embassy visited, they'd given me numbers of loads of charities. At the time, I thought they weren't worth shit. But now it felt like my one shot to getting back home.
At the time, I was a casework lawyer at Reprieve, working on the case of British nationals facing the death penalty anywhere around the world.
We're working for people that, if we weren't helping them, wouldn't have anyone working on their cases at all. And these are guys who would be just sitting in prisons, waiting for their execution date. They'd just be seeing years and years of their life drift by.
Like, it was at a time when Dubai was really in the news and was really popular as a tourist destination. And all of a sudden, we were told there were three young British men who were being tortured over there, and was like, this is a big deal.
He just said, mate, this is so fucked up. He was like, I can't believe what's happened to you. He's like, I don't know if you lot have pissed someone off or something, but something's just not right about this whole situation.
Yeah.
Mark was honest with me. No, he said, Carl, it's going to be a long road and it's not going to be an easy one.
Yeah.
It is David against Goliath, right? You've got the whole machinery of a state like the UAE against Carl. And how can you change those odds?
Speaking to Mark gave me a glimmer of hope again. And he said he'd be out to visit us soon. That put me back in Grant and Sonny's good books. But I still had a very immediate problem to deal with. The whole prison thought I was an arsehole. Especially Abdullah. The foreman hadn't spoken to me since I started that fight in the canteen. So I figured I should keep my head down just for a little bit. Talk about best laid plans. I thought I was being attacked. Loads of guys all in like balaclavas, batons, tasers, everything. They'd come in, rip up your mattresses, look in your pillows, look in all your clothes, just throwing shit everywhere, like, you name it, just spinning the whole place. And I later learned that these were called the ninjas. And they'd come in to see if you're hiding things in your cell. Barik, Abdullah's number two, just had this look of panic. He's like, bro, can you hide this? Can you hide this? Flipping a tiny little SIM card. I could have just wrapped it in a bit of paper and put up his arse. I didn't even stop to think about what was on that SIM or why he wanted me to hide it. And I would have been looking at a long time in solitary and some serious shit if they'd caught me. My body froze, like I heard the sound of a taser again. Absolutely shat myself. I was just acting on instinct. And I got good instincts.
You just kind of know he's gonna be all right in them circumstances. He doesn't get scared. Well, he might do, but he don't show it or tell it.
feel like that was Abdullah's way of just kind of just testing me, just to see, you know, let me see what this guy's about. And he was like, right, listen, look, you're acting a yeah? Like, stop. And he was like, look, we can see something in you. You've got potential. From that moment on, yeah, like, my whole prison experience changed completely. One night, I could smell burgers and, like, hot dogs, and I was like, whoa, what's going on? One of Abdullah's inner circle, he's like, come, 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 come. I'm like, what? He's like, shh, come, 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 come. So I've gone into the foreman's cell.
I'm here, brother.
And they're all sitting down, and there's dishes of food.
Wow. I ain't seen food like this in a long time.
Wow. Like, there was this cheesy mashed potato. There was fried rice. There was chicken. There was all sorts of stuff. I really felt welcomed in at that point. Being able to sit down with all of the guys that were running the prison and actually just eat some good takeaway with them.
Thank you, good man.
The local Emiratis, they have more priority and advantages. They're able to roam around in the corridors time to time, communicate with the police, you know, when something is needed. And usually in most of the blocks, the local Emiratis are the ones in charge of the wing.
Those guys are living nice, you know? So you can either live nice in prison or you can be in prison. And I was like, nah, 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 nah. I want to live nice.
Wasta worked on the outside. Wasta worked on the inside. If you had the right connections, you could have whatever you wanted. Things were finally looking up, and I was getting a visitor.
When I went to meet Carl, yeah, it was my first time in Dubai. It was so hot. It was unbelievably hot. Lots going through your mind when you meet a client for the first time. A very sort of human emotion, which is like, I hope they like me. It's not an easy thing to walk into a room with someone you haven't met and say, hey, tell me about one of the most terrifying, humiliating things that you've ever experienced in your life. Someone like Carl, he was electrocuted in the testicles, and he might not be comfortable talking about that in detail with someone who he doesn't know particularly well.
Don't look so scared, mate. You all right?
I remember him telling me what had happened, the torture that they'd been subjected to.
What Mark really needed was proof that I'd been tortured. So I told him I'd try and get my medical records from the nurse's office. They weren't going to hand them over willingly, so I'd have to sneak them out. It was risky, but it'd be totally worth it if I could pull it off.
Looked in the nurse's door. I was like, can I just go in there? He went, I went, just went straight in there, grabbed them, put them down my pants.
I was out of there before the geezer even clocked.
Gone out, show Mark. He's like, he's like, oh. I feel like he felt like he was a spy in a movie or something. He just took them and put them in his pants. Yeah.
Oh, I'm sure I didn't smuggle it out. Oh, that doesn't sound at all like the sort of thing I would have done. I mean, I genuinely have no recollection of it. I'm really sorry, because that would be a nice story, wouldn't it?
Mark couldn't represent us when we went to trial because he wasn't an Emirati. All he could do was help our lawyers win our case. And he had his work cut out.
مش في حاجة للتعذيب ومش هو ده السلوك اللي بتنتهجه شرطة دبي مطلقا.
As if Mark's job wasn't hard enough, he was also trying to get us off charges before we were moved to the big man prison. Port Rashid is just a holding jail. Shit gets real when you move to Dubai Central Prison. And that could happen at any point.
I'm reluctant to sort of say on the record some of the things that I heard happen at Central Jail. But if those rumours were getting back to Carl, then I can understand that he had a sense of, like, real concern about being moved.
People was getting raped, loads of people was getting stabbed up, like, people was coming out in body bags, like, daily over there. Like, the whole place was just going crazy. My time in Port Rashid could end at any moment. See, if I was going to make something of myself in here, then I needed to act quickly. In jail, you have to have, like, some position of power, whether it be you're the guy that commands the food queue or you're the guy that, I don't know, sells cigarettes or, like, you have to have something about you, otherwise you're just going to get bumped and you're not going to get brought into, like, the inner circle and inner workings of things. I saw a potential job opening up. A bunch of Syrians who worked with Abdullah had been moved into Central Prison. One man's loss was this guy's gain. Abdullah used to pay off one of the high-level guards who had his own restaurant. So we used to order, like, I don't know, like 300 cheeseburgers, 200 shawarmas, like, massive order. He was like, I'll tell you what you boys can do. When all the food comes in at night time, you guys can take charge of selling the food.
I'm a hustler, baby. That's my dad's made. Yeah, I'm a hustler, baby. That's my dad's made. I'm a hustler, baby.
It's all cheap. Nothing was over like a pound or £1.50. And they'd all go within half an hour. On the first day, when we've gone back to him and given him his money back and profit, he's like, bro, the Syrians have been doing this for the last, like, 6 months, and every time I've been down on money. He's like, how have you done it? And I said, honesty. Like, yeah, we still, like, loads of bits and pieces, but always made sure that he had a healthy profit.
If you think it's unbelievable, just know it's true. That is Carl. That is Caesar.
Happy?
Good night.
Carl is an entrepreneur. He's a self-made hustler. He loves it.
Not just a pretty face, eh?
One thing that kept me going day to day was phone calls from back home. But sometimes, the news from London was hard to swallow.
June 26. All our inner circle, the people who we knew at the time, everyone was winning. D-Double-E had just signed with Dizzy Rascal. Plan B was out. The film had dropped by them. I can't remember the name of Plan B's film.
It was like Ill Manners, wasn't it?
Ill Manners, see? That was Ill Manners. That was all filmed in Wanstead. It was great. We were doing festivals. There's not a festival in London that we haven't been to. Carl felt like the loser then, because he was in jail.
All right, mate. Speak for yourself. I was still gigging. My audience was just a bit more captive than yours.
And they used to hear me singing and stuff like that. And they're like, bro, like, you got a voice on you.
You heard me singing?
Yeah, I heard you singing. And it was amazing.
And Abdullah was like, yo, Carl, sing that song about the CID, man. These lot are gonna love it.
Do it now.
I was like, hmm? He's like, yeah, go on, sing it, sing it, sing it. Last week, chilling on them roads in my peeps, them weed split burning in the air. What a fragrance! Money on the floor from blackjack on the pavement. Strange cars coming, you know it's CID them. Literally, like, I remember the Pakistani murderers. They were like, "Baka baka CID." As soon as they heard that word, woo, the whole place just went crazy, and it just erupted.
You see the blue lights coming when you're... I weren't expecting a response like that. But I guess we all had pretty similar experiences with the police. And this song really spoke to them.
Music, it cuts through where sometimes language doesn't even. It's like it is a unifier. In horrible, lonely situations, music is one of them things that can make you not feel alone.
So there was this one night, I was just asleep in my cell, just chilling, just like, I think I'd just had a bash and I've just knocked myself out, like, cause that's how you go, that's how you gotta get through the days in there. You have a sleep. And they pulled us, everyone out of their beds, like, get up, get up, get up, get up, get up, get up.
Turns out there's a limit to how many takeaways you can order in prison before one of the guards takes notice.
General, the police, he come down, he was like, mate, he's like, no. No, 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 no. Like, I proper fucked it for everyone in there.
There went my Western. One ball's up and I went from hero to zero. No smuggling meant no tobacco. We could get by without the burgers, but no cigarettes was another thing altogether.
What is prison like when there's no tobacco?
Tense. Very tense. And everyone's just a bit feisty and whatnot.
And you don't want to be in a lockup with 300 geezers desperate for fags. They'd literally kill for one.
So I was like flipping out, like, I've got to pull something out of the bag, you know?
Those were some peak, peak times. But I did have one small reason to be cheerful. My hand was so fucked that they'd started sending me to the hospital for checkups. You know what they say about a change of perspective?
I remember saying to the guard, I'm like, oh, mate, I need to... And he's like, go on, Carl, go, 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 go. So go to the toilet, sitting there, I'm having a poo, and it just came to me, bing. I was just like, oh, my God, I need to get someone to come in here and leave me a parcel of cigarettes in Doha.
I just needed to get my ass back to hospital.
Just hit the wall, you can do this.
I can't fucking stop thinking about you.
Just hit the wall, bro. Come on, bro, don't think, just do it, bro. Smack it, come on.
No, grab me, fuck.
Bro, you good?
I'm not fucking good, I look all right, you fucking fuck.
It's fucking better work, man. I'm fucking telling you now.
Fuck.
Grant would be on the phone, he'd be like, right, he's just left, boom. So then the guy would go in there, I can't say his name, but he'd put the parcel behind the toilet. And I'd always walk with cling film from the prison, wrap all the cigarettes in the cling film, put it in my nuts, go and get my hand checked, straight into the jail. Still running with ease, marathon not sprinting. Because in Islam, like, you don't touch another man's thing, it's haram. They never patted me here. It's brilliant. Am I a hero now? Yeah. So now we're controlling the tobacco trade. And that's the most important trade to control in the prison. We're probably making like £200 for a day, easy. I fucked up, but I rectified it, and that's how people must have looked at me and thought, oh, do you know what, this guy's actually quite sick.
Enjoy.
We started to make enough money that I could live like a king and still send Amy money home for faith. Things were sweet. Life wouldn't be so easy when we moved to Central. It was all on Mark to get us off the charges before that day came.
we were lawyers, but we were also investigators as well. You want to find out everything, right? Whether it helps your client or doesn't. First thing you have to do is try and establish whether people actually were tortured, right? We obviously want to build up that evidence, and that's where someone like Frank Arnold came in.
I'm a doctor documenting evidence of torture and related abuses. Normally, I'm able to actually see the person face to face. Here, that was clearly impossible. I was therefore reliant on whatever information Mark or the medical information could give me. This is the report on Carl Williams. There was evidence that his left hand had been broken. Specifically, the fifth metacarpal, in other words, this bone. Second, that he had suffered other blows on his body. And third, that it had been subjected to a burn with something like a cattle prod.
Oh, get out!
I would say that what happened to Carl, as he describes it and from the evidence, was indeed torture.
We felt quite strongly that the UAE government should have intervened and just stopped the case, because they weren't torture allegations. He was tortured.
It had been the longest 5 months of my life. But thanks to Mark and Frank, it finally felt like we were making progress. We could go into the new year actually feeling optimistic about our chances. Welcome. But not before spending a Dubai Christmas to really remember.
We'd put together little hampers of chocolates and stuff like that, and we'd given out to a few people. Because during Ramadan, all of the Muslims celebrated with us and like really brought us into the fold. So we were like, look, they wanted to celebrate Christmas with everyone.
I'd come full circle in here. These guys had become like a second family to me, and this weird little place was our home. But then... our time in Port Rashid was up. We were going to Central. Proper prison. Proper scary inmates.
Oh, shit. We're about to go to the murder central now.
What do you mean, bro? We're going to fucking Central.
The day that I'm really ready to the fair, you know him?
Is when they were getting moved to the big jail.
No one can't save you now.
We're all like literally bricking it.
We better stop praying.
You'll never go home. Oof, phone's dead. And I was like, you're a dickhead for saying that.
Three British men
tortured
in custody.
It's no joke, trust, but them show no love. Don't know the road work is hard, they think it's a par, cause the money is fast. So when I see them come, better believe I'll run. Even if they ask me to stay, I'll say yeah, we run the other way. So I hit the food, hit the phones and duck. Plug the cash in, the trees up high. Heard the dogs bark and thought, fuck this. So I ran to Grant's yard and built my spliff. Chilled a bit, let the heat die down. Changed my clothes, I look different now. Went back and got all my food, they'll never catch me the way I move.